If you're looking up at the stars at night, you'd see that most stars don't change. They look the same night after night. But a few stars are dramatically changing. They get much brighter and much dimmer over a period of days, weeks, or months. They're called variable stars. And the most important type of variable star is the Cepheid variable. These stars are so important because they're the secret to measuring large distances. We use these stars to measure the distance to other galaxies. Cepheid variable stars pulse. They get brighter and then dimmer. They grow bigger and then smaller. This is caused by a change happening deep within the star. The gas inside the star is changing transparency. Stars are made up of hydrogen and helium gas. When gas is transparent, it lets light pass through. When gas is opaque, it absorbs light. Inside a Cepheid variable, the gas will become more opaque if you compress it. This is all you need to create a very unstable star. It's what makes the star pulse. Let me show you why. Imagine that inside a star, there's a layer of gas that begins to fall. As it falls, it runs into the layer below it, and it compresses. As it compresses, it becomes more opaque and absorbs more light. As it absorbs light, it heats up. Heat causes pressure to build. The building pressure causes the star to expand. Now this layer expands, and remember, that causes the gas to be transparent. It allows light to pass through it, and the light escapes. After releasing all this light energy, the star cools down. It starts to compress. As it compresses, it becomes more opaque, again, trapping in the light energy. The cycle repeats itself. The trapped energy builds up heat, causing expansion. The expansion causes the gas to become transparent, releasing the light energy. And then it cools again and contracts again. This cycle of expansion and contraction is very similar to a steam engine. In a steam engine, steam heats up, it expands, it pushes a piston out. Then the steam is released through a valve. The same thing is happening in the star, except the star has light instead of steam, and this light is released, not by a valve, but by the gas becoming transparent. This cycle happens when gas becomes more transparent when it expands. But this is unusual. Let's look at the physics of transparency. Scientists normally talk about the opposite of transparency, which is opacity. That means how opaque is the gas? How well does it absorb light? Opacity is represented by the Greek letter kappa. What I've been describing in this video is called the kappa mechanism. That's what we've been talking about, how changes in opacity, kappa, cause the star to pulse. The opacity depends on two quantities that fight against each other, density and temperature. The opacity, kappa, is proportional to the density divided by temperature to the 3.5 power. When gas is compressed, the density goes up. But normally, the temperature goes up too, and opacity is so sensitive to temperature that this increase in temperature will overpower the increase in density. Compressing the gas normally lowers the opacity. But sometimes the temperature doesn't increase, and the opposite happens. Opacity goes up. This happens inside an ionization zone. Ordinarily, a hydrogen atom contains a proton and an electron. But if you supply enough energy, the electron will separate from the proton. This is called ionization. If you raise the temperature high enough, hydrogen will ionize. The same thing happens with helium, but helium has 2 electrons. If you get helium hot enough, it will lose an electron. And if you get it even hotter, it will lose its other electron. There are some parts of the star that are just the right temperature to ionize. It's in those regions that we get this strange behavior that causes the star to pulse. Here's how it works. We have a layer of gas that starts to fall and compress. Normally when gas falls, the potential energy from the fall goes into heating the gas. But if the gas is close to ionizing, the energy will go into ionization, not heat. the gas compresses. This raises the density without raising the temperature. The gas becomes more opaque. It absorbs more light, trapping it in, raising the pressure. The pressure causes the star to expand. Expansion extracts energy. It converts it into gravitational potential energy. Normally, we extract energy by removing heat, by lowering the temperature. But here, the energy comes not from heat, but from undoing the ionization. The electrons get back together with the protons, releasing energy and stabilizing the temperature. The expansion lowers the density without lowering temperature, causing the opacity to drop. Now light can pass through the gas. The light is released like a valve on a steam engine. All this is happening in an ionization zone, where hydrogen and helium are at just the right temperature to start ionizing. Most stars have two ionization zones, one at 10,000 kelvins, where hydrogen and helium each lose an electron, and another at 40,000 kelvins, where helium loses its second electron. Most stars have these ionization zones, but only a few stars are unstable. In a really hot star, these ionization zones are so close to the surface that there's very little material to push out. In a cold star, there's another problem. Heat goes out of a star in two different ways, by radiating light or by convection. Now, I talk about this in another video, but convection becomes the main form of heat transfer for cooler stars. And convection doesn't depend on opacity. All the opacity stuff we've been talking about doesn't matter for cooler stars. If we plot the temperature and brightness of stars, we see that there's this narrow band where stars are unstable. It's called the instability strip. Above this temperature, the ionization zones are too close to the surface to have an impact. Below this temperature, convection takes over. So inside this strip, we have these unstable stars that rapidly expand and contract. These unstable stars, the Cepheid variables, are so important because they let us measure large distances. If a Cepheid variable is small and dim, it will pulse quickly. If it's large and bright, it will pulse slowly. This was first discovered in 1908 by Henrietta Swan Leavitt. By measuring how fast the star pulses, you can determine its brightness. Once you know its intrinsic brightness, you can compare that against its apparent brightness. That's how bright it appears to us after the light has traveled from the star to us. By comparing these two brightnesses, you can calculate the distance to the star. These stars give us a way to measure large distances, and so they are essential to modern astronomy. For more astronomical videos, please click to subscribe.